I thank All India Society and Vikram for including me for this particular session. And today what we will be talking about is our surgical outcomes to make the patient feel happy after cataract surgery. And my talk will be on dry eye, which makes the patient uncomfortable after surgery. So here is one of our patients. He underwent a multifocal IOL implant with the femto-assisted cataract surgery. The surgery went on perfectly well. The surgery was done in both the eyes and lens was centered, as Dr. Amit Porwal has already explained, into a very beautiful position, and there was no surgical complications related to the surgery. Post-operatively, this patient has uncorrected vision of 6x6 in both the eyes and N6 in for reading. That was post-operative day one. And this continued for the 3 months period. And how do you feel? We feel good and very happy about this particular surgery. And what about the patient? How well does the patient feels? And I presume if I feel good, he will also feel very happy about his surgeries. But listen to this patient. She came 3 months after the surgery of both eyes. She says that she has a constant problem for the right eye. It feels as if the eye is blasting. There is an explosive fitted in her eye. And she is not satisfied with the right eye surgery at all. The condition of eye has gone worse. So this is a scenario what we commonly face after the surgery, especially when we do a high-end intraocular lens implantations. And more the patient pays, the more the complications. So we did investigate this patient for dryness, and this is what we found. The tear film breakup time in the right eye was 7 seconds, which was less than normal. 11 seconds in the left eye. Schimmer's test was 15 millimeters and 11 millimeters. The lipid layer thickness we did on LipiView systems, and it came out to be 41 and 45, which was quite below the normal range. We did investigate for the meibomian gland, and we found that they were shortened and they were blocked and the secretions were not complete. Corneal staining was negative for fluorescein, and we diagnosed this patient to be having meibomian gland deficiency and dry eye, which was basically lipid deficient. So now these type of patients, they do present, and they are actually very unhappy patients. Why we miss identifying dry eyes? First of them, we just don't take dry eyes to be a very serious problem. We just look into the cataract and we try to give best possible cataract surgery results to the patient. So why we don't take it seriously? Because the patient have a variable symptoms. They might present with nothing that is complaining of dry eye, or they might have a very severe dry eye. The symptoms may vary with time, the work and the environment in which the patient is working. And the signs are very subtle. We can very easily miss them on examination. Watering is a very common phenomena in these dry eye patients. So once watering is there, the patient also does not complain of dry eye, because it's very difficult to explain sometimes watering in a dry eye case. And of course, there are absent associated ocular diseases. So I call dry eye in a case of refractive eye surgery or a cataract surgery to be an invisible disease, which definitely becomes visible when the surgery is done. What can we do to avoid an unhappy dry eye scenario? So first thing and foremost thing is to identify the problem early, preferably before the surgery. We should consult the patient about the dryness, and that should be done before the surgery and at the time of discharge. And we should tell the patient that some amount of dryness will definitely happen because of the use of medicines and the surgical outcomes. And we should treat the patient if required. That can be done before the surgery or even after the surgery. So understanding dry eye disease is very, very important for us to give a patient a very happy outcome. So what are the, basically dry eye is seen in 75% of the population, and mostly it is seen in a higher age group patients. So most of our cataract patients, they do lie in a higher age group. So most of them, they will be having this dry eye in association with the cataract. And this severity definitely increases with age and in females and in our population, which is Asians. It is associated with systemic diseases like diabetes and autoimmune, which is also very common in this age group. Ocular comorbidities like glaucoma, glaucoma medications, and other diseases, they do have some influence on the dry eye. Surgical factors like type of surgery, what we are doing, the duration of the surgery, the incision area, the incision size, the area of inflammation after the surgery, they also have their role in causing the dry eye. Postoperative medications, especially steroids, the steroids which are non-solvent, the powdered one, they can lead to more dry eye because they can block the meibomian glands and can lead to increase in the symptoms. On the top, poor hygiene of the patients because they are asked not to clean their eyes and they are also afraid to clean their lashes for the risk of infection. Environmental factors like climatic factors, peak summers and harsh winters, they do affect dry eyes. Activities that can prolong blinking, like prolonged reading, using mobiles, working on the computers. Low humidity, wind, force heating and cooling of air conditioners can also aggravate the dry eye condition. 80% of these dry eye cases, they are due to the disturbed meibomian gland secretions or the lipid layer deficiency. See, this is a lipid layer graph from a LipiView machine, which shows that that particular patient, what we discussed earlier, to have 41 nanometers of lipid layer thickness, which is below the normal of 100 values. And these type of patients, they will definitely have an aggravated dry eye after the surgery and will complain. We should understand that dry eye is not only the tear film, and all the layers have to be studied separately. The lipid layer, the aqueous layer, the mucus layer, the ocular surface has to be seen, the lid margins and the meibomian glands have to be seen separately, and on the top, we should also be noting the blink reflex of the patient, because all these things, they do contribute to the overall development of a dry eye. So once we are sure that all these layers are normal, intact, and they're functioning well, then only we do a cataract surgery, then only we will get a very happy patient after the surgery. And if there is any problem in any of these layers, we should treat them early. So identifying a patient of dry eye is very simple. We should give a questionnaire to the patient, and there are plenty of questionnaires available. What we use is a speed questionnaire. It's a fast 2 minutes questionnaire. We ask the patient about the symptoms of dry eye and the severity. Once we fill in this form, this actually creates a disease awareness in the patient's mind before the surgery is being taken up. And if we find that the symptom score is more than 6, we can investigate the patient for dry eye and try to find out what is the actual cause of the dryness. Once we say that the dry eye is there, then we should be evaluating the patient for tear film breakup time. This tear film breakup time will just give us a general idea of all the tear film layers. Then we do a Schirmer's test, which will give us a good idea about the lacrimal function and the aqueous secretions. We do a lipid layer thickness analysis, which will give us a function idea about the meibomian function and the lipid secretions. We should also do a corneal staining that will help us in telling the amount of epithelial damage and will give us a fair idea of the mucus secretions, because if there is a staining, then we can expect there be a goblet cell loss also. Ocular and systemic examinations to rule out ocular comorbidities should also be done. Now, tear film breakup time just gives us a natural capacity of the tears to stay intact to provide healthy ocular and refractive surfaces. If the tear film breakup time is less than 10 seconds, we consider it to be abnormal. Here is the picture of abnormal tear film, which is seen in a 10-second case. Schirmer's test, where we put a Schirmer strip on the lateral half of the lower lid. It basically, we find out the basic and the reflex aqueous secretion of the tears. And if they are less than 5 mm, it's suggestive of severe dry eye. And if it's more than 15 mm, it is a normal tear film. Then we put a fluorescein on the corneal surface and see for the staining. Or we can use Leishman green to see for the conjunctival staining. If there are epithelial defects, it might suggest that there is an altered mucus secretion or loss of goblet cells. There is a simple technique, just press on the corner of the lids and look for the meibomian secretions. We will see if the secretions are coming. If they are clear solution, then it is a normal grade 3 tear film, lipid layer. And if there is a cloudy or a yellowish colored lipid layer, Might yes, little bit of meiobobin secretions are getting worsened. If it is insipated, it comes like a toothpaste. Then it is bad. And if there is no secretions, then it suggests that the meiobobin gland damage is more. It will take another 1 minute. And we look for the lipid layer analysis on a lipid machine. If we see this rainbow pattern on the lipid layer, this means they have a normal and high lipid thickness. And if this rainbow pattern is absent, this suggests that the lipid layer is gone down. We should look for meiobobin gland imaging. This can also be done on our autoref with the infrared cameras. We'll be able to define the amount of damage in the meiobobin gland. They will be shortened, or there will be dropouts, or it will be severely damaged. The patient needs to be consulted if we find that there is a dry eye, and they should be made aware of the disease, especially before the surgery. And they should also be told about the treatment if the dry eye is there, and explain that the surgery can aggravate the disease, and we should also discuss the treatment modalities. The disease counseling should be done before the cataract surgery. A well-educated and aware patient will be least happy, least unhappy. At time of discharge, we will get, if we explain at the time of discharge, we will get a reasonably comfortable patient. And if we do it 2 weeks or later after surgery, we will have a definite unhappy patient. Even if we do the treatment, the patient is not be comfortable. So what are the treatment options available? Artificial tears, cyclosporine drops, hot fermentation or heat pads, punctum plugs. Now the latest is intense pulse light therapy or a LipiFlow technology, which can help in opening up the meiobobin glands and decreasing the dry eye. So for if we have aqueous layer deficiency, we should be going for artificial tears with punctal plugs. If there is a lipid layer defect, then we should be going for doxycycline, hot fermentation, and meiobobin gland expression with the help of lipid flow or IPL technique. If there is an aqueous layer defect, then we should be using cyclosporine, autologous serum, or anti-inflammatory agents like steroids or NSAIDs. Meanwhile, our lady which
Doctor,
presented
sorry
used
to
artificial,
interrupt you.
yeah, just getting over, last slide. We used artificial tear drops. We advise the patient to undergo hot fermentation once a day and intense pulse light therapy, one sitting with manual expression of the gland, and reasonably comfortable. She was reasonably comfortable 2 weeks after the IPL follow-up. So before going for a cataract surgery, we should stop, think, identify, counsel, and treat for dry eye so that we can bring a smile to every surgery. Thank you.